A very good evening to one and all present here. Welcome to the second lecture in the online series on Law of Evidence brought to you by Law Internships. I'm Shilpa Sai and I'm going to be a moderator for today's lecture. To give you a brief about Law Internships, it was started by Mr. Shubham Solanki, co-founder, and Ms. Amrita Jain, partner, with the objective of providing first-hand experience of the day-to-day functioning of various legal bodies through legal internships to law students pursuing undergraduate or postgraduate programs. Today we have with us Mr. Harsh Pratap Singh, the speaker for the lecture series. Mr. Harsh Pratap Singh has a master's degree in law from Rajiv Gandhi National Law University, Patiala, specializing in commercial laws. Sir started his career from School of Law, Christ University, Bangalore in 2013, and is presently working in Keli Society, Karnataka, and holds various positions of responsibilities at institutional levels. Sir has presented several papers at various national and international seminars and conferences. He is a thorough academician and a passionate teacher and has been invited on a regular basis by several institutions as a resource person and delegate for events of academic enrichment. On behalf of Law Internships team, I welcome you, sir. I also would like to welcome all the participants and the team of Law Internships. In today's lecture, we will be primarily dealing with the relevancy of facts and evaluation of evidence, admission, and statements by persons who cannot be called as witnesses. Before we start the session, I would like to request all the participants to mute their mics and turn on your videos. You may type them out in the chat box or use the raise your hand option on your screen. In the last lecture, Sir had covered Section 3 to Section 8 of the Indian Evidence Act. Today, we will be moving forward from the concept of attempt. Without further ado, I would like to hand over the platform to Sir now.
Thank you so much, Shilpa, for the introduction. Thank you all the participants for being here with us. So, a quick recap of last lecture I would like to give you. So in last lecture, we have seen, you know, the subject matter of the Evidence Act, you know, the function, primary function of the court, which is, you know, proving the rights and liabilities of the party, and rights and liabilities of the parties are based upon certain facts, right? So anything that can be seen, that can be heard, which can be felt through sensory organs is a fact. And also anything about which our mind is conscious, right? That's also a fact. And fact and evidence has to be given of facts, correct? Now, what type of facts? Only relevant facts. What are those relevant facts? Relevant facts are those facts which have a logical connection with other facts and fact in issue. So only those facts which have logical connection with the fact in issue or certain other facts are relevant facts. Now those logical connections are explained between Section 6 to Section 55. Correct. So one logical connection, we have seen that facts forming same part of transaction are relevant facts. That is Section 6, res gestae. Then we have seen Section 7, that facts which explain the occasion, facts which explain the cause, effect, or the opportunities, you know, allowing the commission of the crime, they are relevant facts. Then further we have seen Section 8, right? That's motive, preparation, previous conduct and subsequent conduct is a relevant fact. So we were at Section 8, right? So I have explained motive. Motive is different from intention, right? In order to make a person liable for a crime, what is required is mens rea, and mens rea is intention. Correct. Motive is not the concern. Law is not concerned with motive. Substantial criminal law, substantive criminal laws, they are not concerned with motive. It is procedural criminal law, that is law of evidence, which says motive is a relevant fact to prove intention. So always remember terms like, you know, revenge, terms like ambition, terms like jealousy, envy. These are motives. These are not intention. Feeling of revenge, that's not the intention. That's a motive. Revenge compels a man to commit a crime with intention, right? Similarly, you know, if I can give you one more example of the same, I am highly ambitious. I want to earn a lot of money, correct? Let's say I am highly ambitious. Let's say all of us present on this platform today, all of us are highly ambitious and they want to earn a lot of money, correct? Does that mean that we are going to rob a bank, right? I have ambition to earn more and more money. I want to earn a lot. Does that mean that I will form intention of robbing a bank? No. But since I am ambitious, it may sometime move me to commit something wrong. Right? So ambition is a moving factor. It may push a person towards intention. However, it is not intention. Correct? Just because I envy you, does that mean that I am going to steal your diamond ring? Right? Not necessary. Correct? So, envy may move a person to form an intention. Jealousy, revenge may move a person to commit a crime, but it's not always necessary. So it is not necessary that every motive should culminate into intention at subsequent point of time. Right? I may have motive, but I may never intend. Right? I may have a lot of motives against you, but that is not necessary that I may actually intend to cause any harm to you. Right? So this is what we have seen. Similarly, conduct of a person speaks a lot. Now, conduct can be of two types. One is previous conduct. Previous conduct means how accused was conducting himself prior to the commission of the crime. Subsequent conduct means what accused did soon after the commission of the crime. Right? Now, for example, a person is seen roaming suspiciously before he robbed the house. A is a person, right? A is the accused. His movements were suspicious in the locality, in the residency. Right? And A has committed the crime of robbery subsequently. Correct? So how were his movements? How was his conduct prior to the commission of the crime is relevant. And what did he do immediately after commission of crime? Correct? After killing X, I will be naturally absconding. If I commit a crime, if I commit a murder, what will the accused do? If I am the accused, I will immediately try to abscond. Correct? Or, you know, I may sit on the dead body of the victim, right? And without any feeling of remorse on my face, correct? I may be simply sitting near his dead body. I may be simply talking to a dead man, correct? That is also relevant because, for example, you know, if a person who is sane, if he commits a crime, he will definitely try to run away. But if the person is insane, then the person who is insane does not understand the nature and consequences of his act. He may simply sit with the dead body or he may simply lie next to the dead body on the ground. Correct? So, your previous conduct, subsequent conduct speaks a lot. Correct? So, rest of the dimensions of this topic we had already covered the other day. Right? Now, if you may please permit me, since we have too many sections to cover, so covering section 5 to section 55, each and every section in detail, will be little difficult. So what I will do is, I will pick up the most important topics first. Correct? Most important topics I'll cover first, and then the least important topic, less important topics we are going to see in the remaining time. Correct? So you see, next important topic I would like to take this liberty and I would like to start with is the scheme of admissions and confessions. Correct? Please allow me to start with the admissions and confessions. It is very important. So first we'll cover admissions and confessions and rest topics we'll see later. After admissions and confessions, we'll cover dying declaration. Then we'll cover section 11, again, a very important section later on. So you see, when I make a statement, we will start with admissions, right? So admissions will start from section 17 and they will go on till section 30, right? 17 to 30, that is admission. Now, what is admission? If you go by the literal word admission, admission would mean admitting certain things. Correct? When I admit certain things, those are admissions, right? For example, you know, I got late because I had a meeting going on till 4:30, right? It is an admission of the fact, right? I, you know, went to my office in the morning at 9, right? Returned at 4:30. That's an admission of the fact. What did I do? Where I was? These things are admissions, correct? When we admit certain things, those are called admissions. Admissions are covered from section 17, starting from section 17 till section 30. They all are admissions, right?
Excuse me, I want to ask you why the bear act to be shown on screen now?
You can go to Shilpa, you can go to section 17.
All right, sir. Section 17. All right, sir.
Correct. So, how are admissions made? Admissions are made through a statement. Correct. When I say something, that's a statement. And I may be admitting certain facts in that statement. What did I do? Where I was? Correct. With whom I was? Right. So, these are admissions. Now, admissions can be made in three different ways. either I can admit the things orally, right? Or I can admit them in a document, in a written form, correct? Or I can admit certain facts in electronic form. For example, you know, I may record my voice in the mobile phone. I may record my statement in the mobile phone and keep it. That's admission in the electronic form. I may record it in a CD, compact disc. I may record it in a floppy disk. Correct. So admissions can be made in electronic form. They can be made in written form. They can be made orally. Now, as a simple example I'll give you. When you go to bank to open a bank account, right? Bank manager will give you a form, right? In that form, you are supposed to answer certain questions, right? For example, first column will be your name, then your gender, then your nationality, right? Then whether you are married or not. Then whom you want to appoint as nominee in case something happens to you, whom should this money go, right? So they will ask for nominee. They will ask for marital status, correct? They may also ask you whether there is any other bank account you have, right, in some other bank. They may also ask you, is there any pending loan or existing obligation towards the bank which you own, correct? And then they may ask you your Aadhaar card number, your PAN card number, right? So you are filling those forms. When you are filling those forms, actually, what are you doing? You are admitting certain facts, isn't it? You have admitted that your name is Harsh. You have admitted that you are married. You have admitted that this person should be my nominee. You have admitted your nationality, right? You have admitted your Aadhaar card number. You have admitted whether there is any other existing obligation towards the bank pending. So what you are doing is nothing but when you are filling these forms, you are admitting certain facts, right? For example, you go for LLM admissions. Since all of you are in LLB, I presume. So if you fill a form for LLM admission, university will issue you a form. When you are filling the information in the form, you are doing nothing but you are admitting certain facts, correct? This is oral admission. Or I admit that I owe 50,000 rupees to Shilpa. That's admission of a fact. I put it in writing that I owe you 50,000 rupees. So I have admitted a fact that I owe you some rupee. These all are admissions in documentary form. Similarly, I can make admissions in oral form. You can ask me these questions orally and I may admit certain things, right? So they can be made orally in writing, or they can also be there. Somebody says I'm not audible properly. Please check your internet connection. I don't think so. There is any problem from my side, right?
Yes, sir. You're audible quite fine to us.
Maybe some connection problem at the other side. Now, these all are called admissions, correct? So there is a statement. A particular type of statement wherein you admit certain things, that statement, that part of a statement is called admission, correct? Now, a particular type of admission, remember, a particular type of admission is known as confession, correct? Now, what is confession? Confession is incriminating in nature. That means when you admit to the committing of a crime, that admission becomes confession. Right now, for example, if in my admission I say that yes, I was in Bangalore on the alleged date of incident, yes, I was there in the particular locality where the alleged murder is committed, these are my admissions. I was there, I was in Bangalore at that time, I was there. But further, if I go on to say that yes, I was the one who has killed A, if I say that yes, I am the one who has killed A, then this becomes incriminating. I am incriminating myself. And this particular type of admission will become confession, right? So always remember, a statement is the genus, correct? Admission is a particular species of the statement, correct? If you remember, if you recall, we say, you know, that, you know, let's say human being, it's a broader species, it's a genus. And a particular type of human beings, for example, being Aryan or being Dravidians or being Caucasians, right? These are particular species of human beings, correct? Similarly, statement is the broad category, it's the genus. A particular type of statement where you admit certain things, is a species. So statement is genus, admission is species, and a particular type of admission in which you incriminate yourself, it is confession. So confession is a subspecies of admissions. Always remember, confession is a subspecies of admission, right? Now you see, section 17 of the Evidence Act, which is projected on the screen, this section only tells you the ways in which admissions can be made. It only tells you the ways in which admissions can be made. However, if you go on to section 18, so section 17 is very neutral. Correct? Section 17 is very neutral. It does not tell you who can make admission and why admissions are relevant. It does not tell you that. Section 17 is very neutral, and it simply says that admission can be made in oral form, written form, and electronic form. Correct? However, who can make admission? The list is provided in section 18. If you go further, section 19 and 20 will tell you the circumstances in which admissions can be made. Right? 19, 20 will tell you the circumstances in which admissions can be made. If you go to section 21, section 21 will tell you why admissions are relevant. The real game lies in section 21. Section 21 is the real game of admissions. Correct? If you go to section 22, it tells you admissions in relation to the content, oral admissions relating to the contents of document. Correct? If you go to section 23, section 23 is going to tell you admissions in civil cases under certain circumstances. And 24 and onwards, confessions will start. Right? Admission and confession, they both are under the chapter of admission, because admission involves confession. A particular type of admission is confession, which incriminates. Right? So, the whole scheme of admissions and confessions have to be read together with section 58 and section 31 of the Evidence Act. Correct? It has to be read with section 58 and section 31 of the 31 of the Evidence Act. And further, you can also please refer to section 61 and section 63 of the Evidence Act. So if you read these sections only, then your understanding of admissions and confessions will become clear. I mean, you will have a crystal clear understanding only when you read these sections together. Section 17 to section 30, along with section 31, along with section 58, along with section 63 and section 61. Right? So, you see now, you have understood what admission is. Admission is admitting certain things. Yes, I did this. Yes, I had this in my lunch. This is also admission. Yes, she is my wife. Yes, I am married. So anything where you admit, right, is an admission. If you go to section 18 now, who can make admission? So it will provide you certain type of persons who can make admissions. Apart from who is provided in section 18, nobody can make admission. Correct? Section 18, the scheme of admissions is applicable in both civil cases and criminal cases. Remember, right? However, confessions are particular to criminal cases. There cannot be any confession in civil case. Remember this. Admissions are applicable to both civil case and criminal case. Correct? However, confessions are only applicable to criminal cases, because confession, it is incriminating against you, right? Now you see section 18. Point is, who can make admission? So section 18, the whole of section 18, for each of the points covered in section 18, I will give you one liner. Correct? If you are making notes, you can quickly make notes, right? Section 18 says, admissions by a party to proceedings or his agents by suitor in representative character. Let us move further. What is section 18 answering? Bear in mind, section 18 is trying to tell you who can make admission. So with this question, we are going to read section 18. Who can make admission? Answer lies in section 18. Section 18 is read as statements made by a party to the proceeding or agent to any such party to whom court regards under the circumstances of the case as expressly or impliedly authorized by him to make them are admissions. Question was, who can make admission? Point number one, I will give you one liners. Point number one, who can make admission? Party to the proceeding can make admission. If there is a suit between myself and you, then we both can admit certain facts before the courts, right? I can say that, yes, I borrowed money. I can say that, yes, I am the author of this document. I can say that, yes, there was a contract between you and me. So I can make admission. Similarly, you can also admit certain facts. Who can make admissions before the court? You can make admission. I can make admission if we are party to the suit. So point number one is, who can make admission? Party to suit. Point number two, our agents, correct? Our agents can also make admissions on our behalf. For example, if I am the owner of the house, the broker which I have appointed, correct, to take care of my property, to sell my property, to rent out my property, also can make admissions on my behalf, because that broker will be my agent, right? However, between myself and the broker, all the principles of agency should be there, should be established, correct? So who can make admission? Party to suit can make admission. I will simplify this section and tell you in points. Point number two, agents of the parties can make admission. Now, going to this paragraph, second paragraph, by suitor in representative character. What do you mean by suitor in representative character? Third point is, suitor in representative character can make admission. Correct. So I will explain this. For example, Vijay Mallya has defrauded his creditors. Correct. He owes a lot of money to a lot many people, and he has gone to England. Right. So let's say total number of creditors towards whom he owns certain sum of money, right, are 20,000 in India, which includes so many banks, which includes individuals, which includes other companies. He has taken money from 20,000 people and he has flown to England, right? Or maybe he is in India, that does not matter in my example, right? Now, for the recovery of money, is it desirable that these 20,000 people should file a case against him? Indian courts are already flooded with cases. Each creditor filing one single case, 20,000 additional cases will come to courts. It is not desirable. So what we can do is, you know, we can file a suit of representative character, in the sense that, you know, five of us, myself, Shilpa, I can see on a screen, Prerna, I can see on a screen, Harshita, I can see on a screen, correct? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, once I caught a fish alive, right? So, you know, all 20,000 creditors decided that these five people are going to represent us in the suit of recovery before the Indian courts, right? So five of us will be representing 20,000 creditors who have advanced money to Vijay Mallya, and Vijay Mallya has defrauded them. So five of us are going to represent the case of all 20,000. Correct. 20,000 people have consented that, yes, these five people are going to represent us. So we become suitor in representative character. We have filed the suit, right? So we are the suitors. In what capacity? In representative capacity. We are representing 20,000 people standing behind us. Correct. So we five of us can make admissions on behalf of those 20,000 who are behind us. Understood? Because we are duly authorized by them to prosecute Vijay Mallya on their behalf, right? So third person who can make admissions, suitor in representative character can make admissions. We are the voice of those 20,000 people standing behind us. So we can raise their concern. We can make admissions on their behalf. So who can make admission? Party to the suit, agent. Third is suitor in representative character. Now go to the next point. Statement made by, now fourth category, party interested in the subject matter. Any party who is particularly interested in the subject matter can make admissions. Correct. For example, again, Vijay Mallya, forget the previous example now. Now connect it like this. Forget means forget for the time being. Don't forget it forever. So Vijay Mallya goes to a bank, correct? And from the bank, he obtains a loan of 200 crore rupees. That's the amount of loan he has taken from the bank. 200 crore rupees is the amount of loan he has obtained. And he has made a promise to the bank that or you can say that the loan is sanctioned on the condition that 2 months, after 2 months, he is going to start paying the installments, right? See, if you obtain a loan for the car, for the purchase of car, installments will not start immediately. You enjoy your car for a month, next month onwards, installments will start, right? So 200 crores is the loan he has taken, right? The first installment, the installments of repayment are going to start 2 months later. Now, by the end of the first month, right, or before first month could end, right, that is before he could pay his first installment, Vijay Mallya rushes to the bank, right, and he requests the bank to declare him insolvent, right? He wants to get himself adjusted as insolvent, correct? So let's say Shilpa was the manager of the bank who has given 200 crore rupee loan, right? Now she got the news that Vijay Mallya has gone to the bank, right? Now Shilpa is the one who has extended the money. If Vijay Mallya successfully gets an order, if he successfully gets himself adjusted as insolvent, then no suit for recovery can lie against the person who is insolvent. Shilpa was the manager. What will she do? She will immediately rush to the court, correct? Saying that, my lord, don't adjust him insolvent because he has obtained loan from our bank worth rupees 200 crores, of rupees 200 crores. And he is yet to pay his first installment. If you declare him insolvent, public money will go to waste. He will be under loan, no liability to repay the amount. Now you see, she is the one interested in the subject matter. What is subject matter? In money. Right? She is interested in the recovery of the money. Vijay Mallya is interested in getting himself declared as insolvent. So subject matter is the money here. Right? So Shilpa, is she the party to suit relating to insolvency? Answer is no. Is she the one suing in representative character? The answer is no. Is she acting as agent of somebody? Answer is no. But she is the one interested in subject matter of the suit. So she can rush to the bank and say that, kindly don't adjust Vijay Mallya as insolvent because he has 2000 rupees loan he has obtained last month. He's yet to pay this. Are you getting the point? So anybody who is interested in the subject matter can also make admissions. She can go and admit before the court that, yes, I have advanced 200 crore rupees to him. And these are the documents. I hope this point is precisely clear to you. Now, going to next point. Admission can be made by any, can you scroll down? Can you please scroll down? Can you please go to clause 2? Yes. Now, this is the fifth category of person who can make admission, and that is person from whom interest is derived. What do you mean by this? Any person from whom interest is derived can make admission. You see, am I not going to inherit my father's property? As of now, yes. This is what my dad tells me as of now. He believes that I am a good son. So I am going to inherit the property of my father. You all are going to inherit something from your parents, isn't it? So in case of inheritance, in case of succession, you are the one who will be deriving interest from somebody else. This is this point, person from whom interest is derived. Correct? So you are succeeding my property. Correct? Since you are succeeding from my property, you don't have any interest of your own. You are succeeding it from me. You are deriving some interest from me. My admissions are going to be binding against you. Correct? Let's say my father gives me the property. Right? If it is an ancestral family property, I get it by virtue of inheritance. Or I can be the successor to his self-acquired property. So basically, my father is giving property to me. But my father has obtained a loan of 2 lakh rupees from Mr. X. Correct? My father has obtained a sum of 2 lakh rupees from Mr. X. when he gives the property to me, he can say that take the property provided that you pay Mr. X 2 lakh rupees. I have obtained the loan. When I am inheriting from him, when I am succeeding his interest, it is my duty to repay his debt also. Right? So the person from whom property is inherited can make admissions which will be binding upon the person who is inheriting the property. Are you getting my point? Let's say one more example I can give you. I am a big contractor working with Indian Railways. Indian Railways does a lot of its work through outsourcing, right? So there are a lot of contractors associated with road construction and railway department. So I am a big contractor. Let's say Shilpa is a small contractor in the sense that he has just entered into the profession, into this profession of taking up contracts. And I am already an old player. I am a giant in field of this, in this field, particular field of obtaining contract and getting the work done. So Shilpa comes to me and she tells me that, sir, because of this lockdown, I don't have any business right now. So can you, you know, please join me, or can you find me some work? Can you outsource me some work of yours, which I can do and perform? Right? I said, okay, anyways, the order is huge. You can join me in the performance. Correct? So she joins me. So now this is the case of joint contractor. I am contractor one, contractor A, she is contractor B. And we both are performing a particular contract jointly. Now Shilpa does not have any interest of her own in this contract. Rather, she is deriving all her interest from me. Correct? So to all the party, if I make an admission to somebody else, then that admission will be binding her as well. Correct? She does not have any independent interest. Rather, she is deriving interest from my business, from me. Then my admissions as against other parties will be binding her. Is this point clear? Correct? For example, if I have already negotiated for certain raw material at a certain price, that's binding against her. Now Shilpa cannot start fresh negotiations. Shilpa cannot deviate from the terms which I have already made negotiations. She cannot deviate. All my admissions are binding against her because she is the one deriving interest from me. Correct? So who can make admission? Party to suit can make admission. Agents of those parties can make admission. Suitor in representative character can make admission. Then we have seen person from whom the interest is derived can make admissions, right? If you have any doubt till here, you can please unmute yourself and ask the doubts. If the topic is clear so far, then I will go ahead.
In case you don't have doubts right now, but they pop up later during the course of the lecture, please put them in the chat box and they will be answered at the end of the session. Seeing that no one has asked any doubts so far, is it okay that we continue with the lecture? So, I guess we can continue, sir.
Yes. Now you see, section 19 and 20, right, of the Act, they provide for two more special circumstances in which admissions can be made. Correct? Section 19 is a little complicated. First, we will see section 20. Then we will come to section 19. You'll understand better. Right? Now, section 20 says, statements made by a person to whom a party to the suit has expressly referred for information in reference to the matter in dispute are admissions. Apart from the five persons, we have seen section 18. Now this is section 20, which adds one more limb or dimension to section 18. Though not directly, but indirectly. Correct? Five category of persons we have seen who can make admissions under section 18. Section 20 adds one more limb to it, one more arm to it, though indirectly. It says statement made by person to whom party to the suit has expressly referred for information in reference to a matter in dispute or admissions. Correct. So statements are made by whom? Statements are made by a person to whom party to a suit has been referred. Who is making admission here in section 20? If you read it closely, it says statement made by person to whom party to the suit has been referred. Right? Let's say I own 3 properties in Bangalore. And it is difficult for me to manage those properties. So I have appointed a broker, Mr. X. Mr. X is the broker. And I have given full authority to this broker, you know, to advise me on the matters relating to rent, to fix the rent, to rent out the property. Whenever tenant comes, this broker will take care of those of you know, those who are seeking the property on rent. Right? Now you come to me asking that you saw a to-let board on one of my properties. You saw a to-let board on one of my properties. You came to me asking that whether the property is available for rent. And if yes, then for how much price? Then I told you that don't talk to me. Talk to the broker, Mr. X. He is the broker. He will tell you everything. Don't bother me. Go to Mr. X, right? I have referred you, party to a suit has been referred to a person. This is the situation of section 20. A statement made by the person to whom party to the suit has been expressly referred. So I said, don't talk to me regarding my properties. You go to my broker, he will tell you everything. Correct? Now, you went to the broker, right? And broker will tell you that this is the rent. Broker will tell you that this is going to be the secure. This much is the security deposit. Broker will tell you other conditions of lease or tenancy, whatever the case is. Correct. So what is broker doing? Broker is admitting certain facts. Broker is admitting that yes, the rent of this house, broker is admitting that yes, this is a 1200 square feet property. Broker is admitting that the rent of this house is going to be 19,000 rupees per month. Broker says security will be 2 lakh rupees. That's also an admission. Correct. And whatever broker admits, all his admissions are binding on me because I am the one who has expressly referred a party to the suit to a third person. Are you getting this point? Right. I may be desiring, I may be expecting a rent of 20,000 rupees per month. But if my broker has told you 19,000 rupees per month, that's binding against me. Even if I am the owner of the property, I cannot claim 20,000 rupees a month as rent. If his broker has said 19,000, then it is 19,000. If he tells security to be 2 lakh rupees, then it is 2 lakh rupees. It is binding against me because I was the one who has referred you, correct, to a broker, to a third person, right? So you see, this is section 20, correct? Now section 20 establishes one important, very important principle in itself. And that principle is strangers to a suit can also make admissions. You see, in all type, different type of persons, we have seen in section 18, right? Whether it is party to a suit, whether it is agent, whether it is suitor in representative interest, whether it is party interested in subject matter, whether it is person who is deriving interest from somebody else, right? All of them are party to the suit, correct? However, section 20 speaks for a particular situation where a stranger to the suit is making admissions, or the admissions of a stranger to the suit are binding upon parties. Now, let's say in the same example, there is a dispute now between landlord and the tenant, correct? For let's say tenant sues me in the court, correct? Then the admissions which are made by the brokers are relevant. Tenant can prove before the court that when I went to their broker, this is what their broker told me. Are you getting this point? Tenant can certainly say that when I went to his broker, this is what his broker told me, and court can call that broker in the courtroom and take his admissions. So broker is not a party to the suit. Broker is a stranger to the suit, but the admissions made by a stranger are also relevant by the principle invoked in section 20. I hope this point is clear to you, right? Now, coming to section 19, if you read section 19, and even if you read it again after that, it is little difficult to follow. However, it can be understood from a particular example. I can give you an example so that this section becomes clear. However, it is imperative to read the section. I will read it. It says, section 19 provides that admission by a person whose position must be proved as against party to the suit. Statements made by person whose position or liability it is necessary to prove as against any party to the suit are admissions. If such statement would be relevant as against such person in relation to such position or liability in a suit brought by or against them, and if they are made while the person making them occupies such position or is subject to such liability. Right? Even if you read it 100 times, nothing will make sense. Right? So I will give you an example. Let's say there is, one Mr. X who owns a lot of properties in Bangalore. He has, approximately 40 shops in Bangalore at various locations, 10 houses in Bangalore at various locations. Correct? And it is very difficult for this Mr. X, to go personally and collect the rent. It is not possible for him. So he has appointed me, right, to collect rent on his behalf. So I hold a certain position vis-a-vis Mr. X. Correct? I act for him. I do things for him. I collect rent on his behalf. Now, let's say Prerna, I can see her on a screen. Prerna occupies one of the shops amongst all those 50 other shops. Prerna occupies one of the shops. Now, Prerna is very well known to me, right? Let's say old friendship or something. So when I went to her shop to collect the rent, to my surprise, I saw that, Prerna is occupying the shop. So I told Prerna that, since we are known to each other, no need to pay the rent. I will manage it with Mr. X. I said, I will manage it with Mr. X. Sometimes we try to do these favors, when our friends are involved, our family members are involved, that you don't pay, we will see, right? You don't have to purchase food coupon, for the New Year program, I will manage. You just come for the function, right? So it happens. You don't have to, pay anything, for the entry in the show, I will manage it from some pass or something. So the same thing with same approach, I told her that you don't have to pay anything as rent. I will manage it with Mr. X. Now, finally, all the money was deposited by, all the money was handed over by me to Mr. X, right? When Mr. X made a calculation, he found that rent for one of the shops is not there. Right? 3,000 rupees was the rent. So let's say 3,000, the cash was falling short of 3,000 rupees. So Mr. X sued me in the court for the recovery of those 3,000 rupees. Correct? Now you see, in the court, I made a statement that, Prerna never owed any rent this month. Somehow I have to take a defense, right? I have to take a defense. So in the defense, I told the court, I deposited before the court that Prerna owed no rent for this month. Correct? And suddenly Prerna was called to the court. Correct? Court summoned Prerna. Now Prerna said, I was willing to pay him the rent. But he was the one who refused to collect it. She says what? She says that I was paying him rent. But he said, no, no, I will manage it with Mr. X. And she was looking at me, asking me, why didn't you manage it? You said you will manage it with Mr. X, but you didn't do it. She said, I was paying him the rent. I was paying rent to Mr. Harsh, but he was the one who declined to collect it from me. Correct? Now, her admission is binding against me. Right? Her admission, her statement is a relevant fact against me. It's a fact which goes against me. Are you getting the point? So this is a type of situation they're talking about, they're referring to in section 19. Correct? Now, and this is also an exception to the general rule. This also, section 19 also provides the same rule that admissions by stranger to the suit or admissions can also be made by a stranger to the suit. Both section 19 and 20, they provide for same situation. Admission can be made by a stranger to the suit, right? Now you see, section 21, as I said, the real game of admissions lies in section 21. Section 21 actually tells you why admissions are considered as relevant and how admissions are to be taken and proved against the person. Correct? Now, if you are dragged to the court, right, for some cause of action, maybe civil or criminal, if you are taken to the court, if I file a case against you, whether civil case or criminal case, you are only going to make those statements before the court which go on to favor you, isn't it? First, let us understand this by logic. Only then you can appreciate section 21. When I drag you, I file a case against you, what type of statement you are going to make before the court? You are going to make only those statements before the court which go on to favor you. For example, court will ask you, did you kill A? Of course, I will say no, even if I have killed, isn't it? Because saying that I did not kill supports me, it goes in my favor. So we tend to make only those admissions before the court. We tend to give only those statements before the court which go on to favor us. A person will never make admission against his own interest. Write this somewhere. A person will never make admission against his own interest unless it is true. That is why only those admissions which goes against your interest are admissible in the court. You say something which goes in your favor, that is completely inadmissible. You say, I haven't killed, not admissible. If you confess that, yes, I have killed, then court will say, admit this. Because unless and until it is true, no man will make any admission which goes against his interest. Right? Shilpa, will you ever write a note and keep it in your almirah that I owe 50,000 rupees to Harsh sir, unless it is true?
No.
Will you ever write it in your diary where you maintain accounts that I owe 50,000 rupees to Harsh sir and keep it unless it is true?
No.
But you will certainly write it when it is true. If you have actually taken the money, then you will write it. If you haven't taken the money, you will never write it. When you write this, that I owe Harsh sir a sum of rupees 50,000, that's an admission. You are admitting that you owe me a money. You owe me certain sum. And you will only write this when it is true. Otherwise, you are never going to make a statement which is against your interest. I will never say before the court that I killed X. I can say this only when it is true. When I have actually killed and I am prompted by a desire to speak the truth. When I am prompted by a desire to speak the truth, sometimes you are prompted by a desire to speak the truth, isn't it? You know? So, you know, I was a very notorious fellow in my childhood. It was very difficult for my parents to handle my adolescence, right? So, you know, I had made so many mistakes, you know, did so many bad things when I was in my college days. And when, you know, my heart was filled with remorse, I sat in front of my mom and I told each and everything bad I did in my life so far till then. I made all the confessions before her. right? She was not prompting me to say anything, but I confessed everything. Correct? Because that day I was prompted by a desire to speak the truth. So I made statements which were against my interest. Right? So in the same way it goes, right? That you will never say anything bad against you, either unless it is true or you are prompted by a desire to speak the truth. So whatever you say which goes against your interest is admissible. Thus, remember the thumb rule that admissions can only be proved when they go against the interest of the maker. That is, my admissions can only be proved against me. My admissions can never be proved in my favor. My admissions can be proved only against my interest. Are you getting this point? I hope this principle is clear to you. If not, you may ask me to repeat again. I will repeat. Because if this is not understood, there is no point in proceeding further. If there is any doubt so far, you can unmute yourself and ask me.
Sir, can you again repeat the point which you made just now?
Anyone else? Any other doubt apart from this?
If anybody has any doubts or questions, please unmute yourselves and you can ask, sir, or you can put it on the chat box. So there seem to be no questions at this point of time. So we can continue with Prashant's question.
So if the audience have understood my point, they can unmute themselves and they can say that, yes, we have understood. Because, you know,
we have understood.
Because unless and until you respond, you know, I won't be proceeding further. I'll keep repeating the same thing. So if you have understood, you can please say yes. Unmute the mic and say yes.
Sir, we have understood, but I have a question regarding Section 18, Clause 2, where you spoke about a person from whom interest is derived. For example, if my father is transferring the inherent property to me and my father has made the loan, will the loan also be transferred to me?
Yes. If you are deriving interest from your father, it's your liability to repay the loan as well. The loan will come with the property. Right, Prashant?
Yes, sir.
Loan will come with the property. You will have to discharge his obligation first. Correct. So we will go ahead. I presume that all of them have understood. Now, there are three exceptions to this rule. Correct. Exception to what rule? Admissions can only be proved against the interest of the person making it. And they cannot be proved in the favor of the person making such admission. There are three exceptions to this rule. Three exceptions to this rule in the sense that there are three special situations in which admissions of a person can be proved in his favor. Correct? So general rule you have all understood. Now we are talking about exceptions. There are three exceptions to this rule. And under those three exceptions, admissions can be proved even in the favor of the person making such admission. First rule is dying declaration. Correct? The person who is dying. Right? Now, it is believed that no man is going to meet his creator with a lie in his mouth. You will not have a lie in your mouth when you go on to meet your creator. Every motive of falsehood is silenced. When you're on the deathbed, there is no motive to speak, you know, something which is false. There is no motive to give falsehood. Correct. So a person who is on the deathbed, when he makes certain admissions, even if those admissions are in his favor, they are going in his favor, those admissions will be taken as true because death is the guarantee of truth. Right. Death ensures truthfulness of the statement, not death, but expectation of death ensures truthfulness of the statement. Correct? So if a person who is on the deathbed, who is in the expectation of death, makes a dying declaration, and in that dying declaration, he makes certain statements which go on to favor him, then those statements are taken to be relevant, even if they favor him. Second exception is any person makes a statement as to the existence of a state of mind or body. Person is making a statement as to the state of his mind or the state of his body. Correct? And when this statement of mind or body are reflected in his conduct, when this statement of mind or body, they are also reflected in his conduct. That means conduct is the guarantee of truth. Right? State of mind is also coupled with the conduct. That is the guarantee of truth. Then statements, even if they are going in his favor, are admissible. Correct? Now let's say, you know, police accuses or police has accused me for killing Mr. A, correct, at 9 a.m. near Dairy Circle, Kormangla. That's an accusation against me. That's the charge against me in the FIR. Correct? That day, I did not go to university. Which university? School of Law, Christ University. Let's say I'm still there, right? I did not go to college that day. Prashant and Shilpa, they were my students in Christ. So they also did not go to college that day. However, they met me on a medical store outside. Correct? They met me, they saw me on a medical, they actually met me on a medical store outside at around 8:45, right, in the morning. So Prashant asked me, sir, you are not feeling well, it seems. How come you are at medical store? Then I told him that, you know, there is excruciating pain in the lumbar back, in the lower back, right? Excruciating pain, unbearable pain. And that's why I cannot go to the school. I could not attend the college today, right? It is very difficult for me to move around. With great difficulty, I have managed to come to the medical store. The pain is visible. Pain is what? It's a state of body. The pain is visible in my conduct. The pain is visible in the way I'm talking to you. Pain is reflected from the face. Pain is reflected. You know, anybody can see me and tell me that this man is in great discomfort. Correct? But at the same time, on the same day, police has accused me for having committed a murder on the same day at 9 a.m. near the Dairy Circle. Correct? If I go to the court and depose before the court that I did not kill, I was in excruciating pain that day, that it was even difficult for me to move, will court admit this statement? The answer is no. But Prashant may come and testify before the court. Shilpa may go to the court and tell the court that we met sir and he was in extreme unbearable pain that day. We could see this from his conduct. Even the owner of the medical store comes there and says that yes, his state of body was reflected in his conduct. Correct? Even I could see that. Then this statement goes in my favor. But since it is in relation to a state of body, which is reflected in my conduct also, conduct ensures the guarantee of truth. And this statement made by me, this admission made by me, will be admitted in my favor. I hope this is clear to you. Now coming to the last exception to this rule, an admission may be proved by or on behalf of the person making it. That means admission can be proved on behalf of the person making it in his own favor when the statement, that is admission, is relevant otherwise than his admission. Correct? That means a statement can be proved in my favor when it is not relevant under the chapter of admission. I mean between section 17 to section 30. But if it is hit by other provisions of relevancy, then it is permitted to be admitted under other provisions of relevancy. That means, for example, a statement I made in my favor, which is also relevant under res gestae section 6, that can be proved in my favor. Because res gestae, I told you, continuity of the actions ensures truthfulness of the transaction. For example, I was fighting with A. It was a street fight. Fight broke out in the street, not a street fight. Fight broke out in the street. And when we were fighting together, all of you were bystanders. All of you on my screen, you were actually bystanders. And when A was beating me, or when I was also eventually hitting A, I was continuously telling A that I did not steal anything from you. You are making a false accusation against me. Correct? Or I was not the one, you know, who threw a stone in your house. Correct? Something like this. Now, this is happening in res gestae. You people saw two people fighting. You all saw two people fighting, myself and Mr. A. And I was making certain statements. Now, this is an admission that I did not do it. Correct? An admission of exculpatory nature, denying my guilt. And Prashant can certainly go before the court and say that, yes, a fight broke out between the two. And Mr. Harsh was saying that I was not the one who has thrown a stone in your house. He was making an admission which goes in his favor. But since this statement is also relevant as res geste, it is admissible, even if it is made in my favor. So basically, when your statement is relevant, otherwise than as admission, admission is a type of relevant fact. But there are several other relevant facts between section 6 to section 55. So if it is relevant otherwise than as admission, then it can be considered in your favor. Correct? Now in the background of this is explanation, what I have given you right now, we are going to give a quick reading to section 21. See, section 21 says, admissions are relevant and may be proved as against the person. It says as against the person. It does not say by or on behalf of the person. It says against the person who makes them or is representative in interest, but they cannot be proved by or on behalf of the person making them. My admissions cannot be proved on my behalf or by me. My admissions can only be proved against me. This is what is written here. Admissions are relevant and may be proved as against the person who makes them or his representative in interest, but they cannot be proved by or on behalf of the person who makes them or by his representative in interest, except in the following cases. Right? Except in the following cases means what? They can be proved by or on behalf of the person making it in these three cases. Correct? First is, admission may be proved by or on behalf of the person making it when it is of such a nature that if the person making it were dead, it would be relevant under section 32. Second point, an admission may be proved by or on behalf of the person making it when it consists of a statement of the existence of a state of mind or body relevant or an issue made at or about the time when such state of mind or body existed, and it is accompanied by the conduct rendering its falsehood improbable. That means my pain was so much so reflected in my conduct that its falsehood was improbable totally. You cannot rule out that I was not in pain. Similarly, it can be related to a state of mind. You know, Prashant can say that, you know, sir was furious on that day. He was extremely furious on that day. Right? All the time students keep saying this only, that her sir is furious, her sir is always furious. I'm never furious, I only have a bad face. Right? So, this is the point. Right? I hope these points are clear to you. If they are clear, I will go ahead.
So, this is just to inform you that it's we have 50 minutes left in this session. This is the timekeeping check, yeah. But if you would like to extend, of course, that's your prerogative.
5050, right? Yeah,
15. 15, sir. This session is still 6 o'clock, so it's 5:45 now. Yes, sir. I'm just letting you know.
10. I may take it till 6:10. I'll compensate that.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, sure, no problem, sir. Just letting you know. Thank you.
Yes. Now, coming to section 22. Section 22 simply states a rule. And section 22, if you want to have a complete understanding of section 22, read section 22 along with section 62, 63, 64, 65, and 66. Right? Now, section 22 says, oral accounts of contents of document cannot be given. Which means what? Now, for example, there's a contract between myself and Prerna, right? There's a contract, written contract, correct? Now, Prerna sues me for the breach of contract, right? And she tells Mr. Magistrate that this was also written in the contract and Mr. Harsh did not do it. She's trying to orally tell what's written in the contract. Court will say, stop. Don't give testimony of oral accounts of, don't give oral account of contents of document. Rather, bring the document. Correct? You cannot say that, okay, this is written in that book. Court will say, bring the book. Isn't it? So, oral account of contents of documents are not permissible. Correct? However, there are certain, you know, conditions which are laid down in section 65. When oral account of contents of written documents are permissible, those conditions are like when the document has been lost or destroyed, right? When the document is of such a nature which cannot be brought to the court, right? When document is in the possession of adverse party. Now, Prerna sues me for a breach of contract. Sues me for a breach of contract, so I become the adverse party. If I have original contract document with me, will I ever give it to Prerna? I will not give because she is fighting a case against me. Document, if it is in the possession of adverse party, you cannot fetch the document. You cannot get the document, right? So when document is in possession of adverse party, only in such cases, court can admit oral accounts, correct? But oral accounts of contents of document from only those will be taken who have themselves read the document, not from anybody else. Now, this is section 22. Section 23, I give it for self-reading. You can read it yourself. You can read at home yourself. It's a small section, correct? It's like this, you know, however, I'll give you a, you know, hint of it. It's like this, that, you know, I make you an offer. I made an offer to Prashant, right? I made an offer to Prashant. And I told Prashant before making the offer that, Prashant, if you don't accept my offer, correct? Please don't admit the facts of this offer before the court. I told Prashant that you are at the liberty to accept my offer or reject the offer. However, if you decide to reject my offer, then don't admit these facts, what I'm telling you, before the court. Correct? So such type of arrangements can be made in between the parties. Right? I will read it quickly. It says, but however, this is applicable only to civil cases. In civil cases, no admission is relevant if it is made either upon express condition that evidence of it is not to be given, or under the circumstances from which court can infer that the parties agreed together that evidence of it should not be given. Right? So I told you that you are ready to, you are open. I mean, you can reject my offer, no problem. But if you decide to reject my offer, don't give evidence of this offer before the court. Correct? You may seem it weird that, you know, this section 23 amount to ousting the jurisdiction of the courts, but that's not the case. There is a public policy behind section 23, and the public policy involved behind section 23 is that parties are always free, or parties should be let free to bargain for their own peace. Correct? If with this kind of arrangement we can bargain for peace, then parties should be permitted. Correct? My peace comes how? My peace comes that I will make an offer to you. If you want to accept, accept. Want to reject, you reject. But don't give evidence of it before the court. So what I'm doing is I'm bargaining for my own peace. And that's permissible. It does not amount to ousting the jurisdiction of courts. Correct? Now, coming to the most interesting part of, you know, admissions, and that is confession. Right? Now, my question to all of you is, and you should all respond, right? My request is that all of you should respond to my question. Shilpa, do you have CRPC, Bear Act?
Sir, right now I don't have the Bear Act, but I can just download it if you would like to put it on the screen, sir.
You can stop presenting meanwhile, and please download section. Just type it, and Google it on the screen.
All right. So section what, sir? Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
164 CRPC.
All right, sir. Sure, sir.
Now you see. Now coming to a particular subspecies of admission, that is confession. Now listen to me carefully. If you have any doubt, then please, please respond to my question now. Confession is an incriminating evidence. I hope you all know it. Incriminating in the sense, when I say that, yes, I was the one who has committed theft, or yes, I was the one who has killed, then I am incriminating myself. Correct? However, Article 20 sub clause 3 of the Constitution provides that no person shall be compelled to give incriminating evidence against himself or herself. Right? Section 164 provides for recording of confession, how confessions are to be recorded. On the other hand, say Article 20 sub clause 3 gives you a right, fundamental right against self-incrimination by providing that no person shall be compelled to give incriminating evidence against himself or herself. So don't you think Section 164 CRPC is unconstitutional?
Sir, if I may answer this question.
Please. Good to see you, Kirtana.
Yes, thank you, sir. So the idea of the procedural law is that it brings about a balance between fundamental and statutory rights. Now, having said that, the aspect of fairness is ensured by virtue of having to caution the person who wants to confess. The procedure clearly states that the judge, whoever is recording the confession, will explain to them that it will be incriminating, that it is against them, and only when they have been cautioned completely, and this caution is also written and it's taken on record. And that is how I feel the fairness in the procedure was established.
Anyone else? Don't you think the whole scheme of confession is unconstitutional? It is violative of Article 20 sub clause 3.
Anyone else?
Sir, it would not be, sir, because when the parties are called to the court, the magistrate himself asks whether the confessions which are to be accepted in the court, whether was it by way of coercion or any other inducement, external inducement in which he is making such statement. So it is creating a balance between fundamental rights, and the magistrate also specifies that every person, the person who is making confession to confession that whether he is accepting the offense which he is committed.
Atreya? Atreya, would you like to answer this?
Hello. Are you able to?
You're not audible, Atreya. Okay.
But I was.
There's a problem, Atreya. You're not audible. Okay, now listen. 20 sub clause 3 says that no person shall be compelled to give evidence against himself or herself. The word to be underlined here is compelled. No person shall be compelled. Can you tell me what is the just opposite of compelled?
The opposite of compelled will be forced or coerced. Consensual. Yeah, sorry. I thought I got it wrong.
What is the just opposite of compelled? I'll give you one word. I hope you all will agree. The just opposite of compelled is
voluntary.
Correct. That's the word which is just opposite of compelled. So 20 says no person shall be compelled to give evidence, right, against himself or herself. But if the person voluntarily gives evidence against himself or herself, then it is admissible, isn't it? If compulsion is removed and confession, if it is coming voluntarily, then it becomes a valid confession. Isn't it? So, remember, this voluntarily is the word which is doing magic between an incriminating statement and right against incrimination. Correct? What is creating a balance between confessions, which is an incriminating statement, and right against incrimination, self-incrimination? What is balancing between the two? This word voluntarily is doing the work of, is doing the act of balancing. On one hand, confession being an incriminating statement, and on other hand, right against self-incrimination. So these two things are balanced by this word voluntarily. Confession is valid, perfectly valid, if it is given voluntarily, right? Now, before starting with Section 24 of the Evidence Act, the reading would be incomplete if I don't refer to Section 164 of CRPC. Now, Section 164 CRPC provides for recording of confession. Section 164 CRPC is doing that act of balancing. Section 164 CRPC ensures that contract, that the confession is recorded voluntarily. There are several safeguards in Section 164 itself, and there are several safeguards which have been pronounced by the courts, right, on recording of confession, safeguards on recording of confession, only to ensure that the confession is recorded voluntarily. Correct. You must not have paid attention, but I will read Section 164 and try to highlight that those safeguards, those points which will ensure that the confession is voluntarily recorded. Keep noting them, right? Keep counting them. 164 subclause 1, it says, any metropolitan magistrate or judicial magistrate, whether or not he has jurisdiction in the case, can record confession or statement. See this. Who can record confession? Any magistrate basically can record confession, whether he has jurisdiction in the case, whether he has no jurisdiction on the case. And why such a provision, can you tell me? Anybody can answer why such a provision? Why any magistrate is given power? Why not the magistrate who has jurisdiction over the case should only record confession? Why can a confession be recorded by anybody, any magistrate, whether he has jurisdiction, whether he has no jurisdiction? Can anyone answer this? Give me a wrong answer, but please.
Sir, if may I?
Yes, please. What's your name?
Harshita, sir. Sir, maybe sometimes it's not possible to reach the magistrate which has the jurisdiction over the case. So the time maybe because is the issue. That's why every magistrate who is nearest to the crime scene may be allowed to record the confession.
Partially correct, to some extent. Can I be heard now? Atreya, yes. Please tell me.
Hi, sir. This is Atreya. So I think one of the main points about recording the statement of the witness by the magistrate is because you have to get the testimony of the witness at the first instance. So while it is fresh and to ensure that there's no detraction of the testimony at a later stage. So that's what 164 essentially hopes to give, and also it can be used for a corroboration of the witness's testimony at trial, and it could strengthen the position and the veracity of the case of the prosecution, I think.
Try to bring in the logic, but the answer is this, that any magistrate is empowered to record confession for the reason that it may so happen that if you wish to go to a particular magistrate and you have a doubt that this magistrate may be biased against me for the reason that he is closely linked with the other party, correct? Or you may feel that this magistrate has got some interest in the case, some personal interest in the case. And if you don't feel like going to him, see, confession should come out of your own free spirit, your own free will, correct? There should not be any foundation when you are giving confession. Voluntarily means what? When you are moved by your free will, that's voluntarily, correct? So without any pressure, without any compulsion, confession has to be recorded voluntarily. So this is the first safeguard, that any magistrate is authorized to record a confession. If you don't feel like going to magistrate A for the reasons I said above, you feel that, reasons I said before, you feel that he's biased or so, go to magistrate B. If you don't feel comfortable with magistrate B, go to magistrate C. If you don't feel comfortable with him, go to some other magistrate. But get it recorded. Go and record it wherever you feel comfortable, and wherever you feel that your voluntary spirit will not be breached. Sit next to any magistrate, right? Wherever you feel comfortable. This is the first safeguard, right? If a magistrate has jurisdiction over the case, he may be having some biases against the person on whom the case is filed. So this is first safeguard to ensure voluntary nature of the confession. Go and record it anywhere where your free spirit is not breached. It is not violated. Correct? Now you see, go to the second proviso. Further that no confession shall be recorded by a police officer on whom the power of magistrate has been conferred under law. Police officer cannot record confession, second safeguard, to ensure voluntary character of confession. Police officer cannot record confession. Why? Otherwise, police official will beat you up in lockup and extract the confession from you. Anyways, police is infamous for its brutalities and tortures, right? Correct? So, if police officer cannot record confession, if the confession given to a police officer is to be relevant, is to be declared relevant, then police officer will beat you up in the locker, take your statement by force and compel you to sign there, right? And it will be in violation of Article 20, Subclause 3. This proviso is second safeguard. Now you read further. Magistrate shall, before recording confession, explain to the person. He should not state to the person. He should explain to the person making it that he is not bound to make this confession. And if he does so, then it may be used as evidence against him. Correct? This is fourth safeguard. Magistrate shall not mechanically state. See, we all are law students. So if I tell you that, you know, if you make this confession, it will be used as an evidence against you. Correct? You will understand it, what I'm trying to tell you. But the accused may be very illiterate, downtrodden. He may be the last man in the line. Correct? Completely ignorant of the world, what's happening around him. So section says magistrate will have to explain till the time he doesn't understand what is the meaning of self-incrimination. He should not mechanically state this caution. This is a caution. Magistrate has to caution the other person that you are not bound to make this confession. And if you make this confession, it may be used as an evidence against you. Correct? So magistrate should explain it to him. What are the implications of making a confessional statement? How it can be used as an evidence against him? Right? So this is fourth caution. Next caution you further see in the same subclause 2. And the magistrate shall not record confession unless upon questioning the person making it, he has a reason to believe that it is made voluntarily. Magistrate should ask certain preliminary questions to him that are you making this confession voluntarily? Has police compelled you? Has any other person, you know, offered some inducement threat to you for making this confession? Right? So magistrate should record it after ascertaining that this person is giving the confession voluntarily. This is fifth safeguard. Right? You see how carefully section 164 is drafted. Correct? I must tell you before I proceed further that recording a confession is a very pious duty of a magistrate. Very pious duty. Correct? Pious in the sense that, you know, you must have seen this in movies. You know, in old times, this practice was followed that, you know, accused who has committed some crime, the person who has committed some crime will go to a church, right? Behind the wheel will sit a father. And from the other side of the wall, this person will make confessions, right? The father, the priest who is taking this confession has got a very pious obligation that he will pray for this man, the person who has committed the sin, and this priest will also not disclose it to anybody, right? All the confessions which were made to the priest were held in utmost secrecy by this priest, right? So, the same way, magistrate has a pious duty to record confessions with a very clean heart, with a very clean mind, right? He should record the confessions, correct? Now, next, going ahead. If at any time before the confession is recorded, the person appearing before the magistrate states that he is not willing to make confession, the magistrate shall not authorize the detention of such person in police custody. Can someone explain what is the meaning of this point, clause 3? Now, let me explain it with an example. Correct? I was the police officer who arrested Prashant. And I am interrogating him. Correct? 24 hours of police custody I can have. For 24 hours I can have in police I can have him in my custody. In the evening, right, at around 4:30, Prashant says, I want to make a confession. Right? I became really happy. So with a lot of efforts, I arranged for a police vehicle. With a lot of efforts, I arranged for, you know, the constables. I took him in my jeep to magistrate's court. He goes to the magistrate courts and he says that no, on the way I have changed my mind. I won't be confessing now. Then I am the SHO, I will be disappointed. My whole police party will be disappointed. Right? That with a lot of efforts we brought him to the court. Now he is refusing to make a confession statement. We will take him back to the police station. And then we will beat him left and right for bothering us. Isn't it? Correct? So this section says, this clause says, that if a person refuses to make confession, if a person changes his mind, if a person tells the magistrate that he is not willing to make a confession, then magistrate will not send this person to police custody again, because police will beat them up there. So magistrate will send him to jail, judicial custody. I hope this point is clear. This is again a safeguard to ensure voluntary character of the confession. And after the confession is recorded, look at the nature of this memorandum. It says magistrate will have to personally sign this, that I have explained to Mr. So-and-so that he is not bound to make a confession statement, and that if he does so, any confession he may make may be used as evidence against him. And I believe that this confession was voluntarily made and it was taken in my presence and hearing, and it was read over to the person making it and admitted by him to be correct, and it contains full and true account of a statement made by him. I will have to sign this personally as the magistrate that I have explained that he is not bound to make confession. In my opinion and knowledge, this confession is made voluntarily. This confession was made in my presence and hearing, and I have read over this confession to the accused. It may so happen that you may say something and I may write something else. So magistrate will have to, after writing the confession, he will have to read it over to the accused again. And when the accused say, yes, this is what I have told you, you have written the exact same thing, then magistrate will put his signature. See, two more safeguards. One is memorandum itself, and magistrate will have to read over the confession. Are you getting this point? Now you can stop presenting. Prerna, you can stop presenting now. Right? So I hope you could see how many safeguards are there in section 164 only to ensure that confession is recorded voluntarily. Correct? If you read the memorandum carefully, you will understand that, you know, what kind of pious obligation a magistrate has, what kind of duty, a job a magistrate has while recording a confession. Right? Now, there are several legislative, several cases Supreme Courts have held, Supreme Court has given so many guidelines in order to ensure that the confession of, recording of confession is done voluntarily. First guideline, first point I can tell you, that while recording the confessional statement, no police officer should be there in the room. Correct? Because presence of police officer creates psychological pressure. When there is pressure, it cannot be said to be given voluntarily. Point number two, handcuffs should be removed. No confession can be recorded when handcuffs are on. Voluntary nature of confession gets distorted. Third point, confession cannot be recorded in the presence of the co-accused. Myself, Kirtana, Shilpa, Atreya, Prashant, Harshita, all of those whom I can see on my screen, all of us has committed the crime. And before going for bank robbery, we made a promise to each other, pinky promise, right? That we are not going to give out each other's names. Right? We will stand with each other. Pinky promise, you all understand, I hope. What is pinky promise? Pinky promise is you break the promise and you die. Yes, you break the promise and you die. Right? So, we have made pinky promise to each other that we will stand together. We will never release the names. We will never tell the magistrate what happened actually. Right? Such kind of pledges and vows we have taken. And now I am prompted by desire to speak the truth. I want to speak the truth. I want to confess. If I start confessing in their presence, these people will start beating me up in the court itself. They will say that what you made a pinky promise and still you are confessing. You cannot do this. Right? So no co-accused should be there in the room. Right? Further, the court also have held, Supreme Court has held that when magistrate gives the caution, what is the caution? That you are not bound to make this confession, and in case you make this confession, it can be used as evidence against him. Right? Reality may hit the accused for the first time then. It may be for the first time person may understand that what is self-incrimination and all. So after this caution is given, magistrate should give him 15-20 minutes time to think, relax, right, and decide for himself whether he wants to go ahead with confession or not. Right, this time lapse should be there, 15-20 minutes, half an hour, whatever magistrate thinks reasonable. This man should be made to sit in the courtroom after the caution is given and let him think, because now he is being cautioned, now he got to know that it can be used as an evidence against him. Right, immediately after cautioning him, don't start writing. Right, give him time to think and relax. Right, courts have held that, you know, when the person is taken from police custody to the magistrate for recording of confession, magistrate is free to conduct a medical examination of this person first. It may so happen that this person is brutally beaten up in police custody and he is forced to, and he is made to stand before the magistrate to get a confession recorded. So magistrate may first, before he can record confession, he may get a medical examination done to see whether this man, how this man is treated in the police custody. In case the accused requests that I was beaten in police custody, kindly get my medical examination done, then on the request of the accused also, magistrate can order a medical examination. After being satisfied with the report, magistrate can go ahead with the confession. If magistrate finds that accused is just bought out from the police custody and he seems to be in a lot of psychological pressure, magistrate may put him in jail for 3-4 days where he can get time to calm down his nerves. And after 3-4 days, he can be called again for recording of confession. So recording of confession is not a ordinary, is not like an ordinary statement being recorded. Correct? A lot of caution should be observed while the confession is recorded. Otherwise, it will stand in violation of Article 20 sub clause 3. That's a constitutional guarantee, fundamental right. Correct? Now you see, Shilpa wants to warn me, sir, that you are exceeding time. So I will stop here. But in this background, we'll start tomorrow. I mean, whenever is the class? I guess on third day from today, right? So we will meet again on 6th. I hope, you know, there are some takeaways from today's lecture. And
definitely, sir.
Yes.
Yes, so Shilpa. We've come to the end of today's lecture. On behalf of Law Internships, I, Shilpa Sai, would like to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Harsh Pratap Singh for taking time out of his busy schedule and accepting our invitation to deliver this intellectually stimulating lecture. Thank you, sir. I would also like to thank all the participants for attending this lecture and making it a fruitful session. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.